Well, good evening, everyone, to the February 27th edition of the monthly Portsmouth Police Commission meeting. And I welcome everyone in the audience. It's a terrific night for celebrating a number of officers. And to start us off, we'll do the Pledge of Allegiance. And I'm hoping Commissioner Hilson will lead us in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Could you believe I had a brain freeze?
Oh, I know. I did it last week with Karen's name. You know, it is a senior outfit here.
Wow.
Yeah.
So I would recommend, given the members of the audience here, that we begin the celebration. And if I could have a motion to suspend the minutes and proceed to the chief's agenda.
So moved.
So moved. I got two so moved. We'll assume one of those is a second.
I'll give it a second.
Second. And we vote on that.
Aye.
And chief, I'll turn the meeting over to you.
Thank you, Commissioner. So I'd like to start off with just letting folks know what we have on the agenda here tonight. We'll be swearing in Auxiliary Police Sergeant Alana Dubanowitz.
Dubanowitz.
I practiced that too. I also, we're going to be welcoming back two of our officers from deployment. In the military, Officer Bill Werner and Officer Alan Laughlin for their recent deployments overseas. We're going to be recognizing two police officers, Officer Chris Worthington and Jack Maloney, for a letter of commendation. And we're going to be having an additional recognition, Chief's Commendation, Chief's Award for Officer Keegan Pearl. So without further ado, I'm going to start off with Alana. Would you come up to the podium? I'll stand here so I don't have to. Just so after a competitive selection process, which included an oral board before ranking officers, it was the decision of the ranking board that Auxiliary Officer Alana Dubanowitz should be promoted to fill the open sergeant's position in the Portsmouth Police Auxiliary. Raise your right hand. It is my pleasure to vest Alana with the supervisory authority of sergeant by virtue of the authority vested in me through the commission by RSA 105CA and the Portsmouth City Charter Amendment E, trusting in your experience, integrity, and fidelity, I do hereby promote you to the position of Sergeant of the Auxiliary Unit of the Portsmouth Police Department with all the power and authority subject to all the duties and liabilities when on duty by special direction of said commissioners as provided by law. Your promotion is effective immediately. Congratulations. Who would you like to pin you? Huh? Okay. Just pop your shirt out a little. There we go. New shirt too.
Yep.
Of course. Police Commissioners would like to congratulate you.
Congratulations.
I'd like to ask Officer Bill Werner to come up to the front too, please. This time too, I just would like to recognize all the family members that are here. I've said it before, you know, we don't do this by ourselves. We don't do this job alone, but I have a special place for the officers in this department that are also serving in the military. I've had the opportunity to meet your families, and I've met a lot of the wives here, and I appreciate the support that you not only give to your loved ones, but you give to this police department. But I think when we have officers like Bill Werner and Alan Laughlin, who not only are serving this city, but serving this country overseas, it means a lot to us. And I know I had the opportunity to speak with Bill's wife during the Christmas celebration here, and he was still deployed. And not only do they make enough sacrifices with the work they do here at Portsmouth, but being overseas, and especially during the holiday season, was a tough time. So I can't say enough about what they do. Officer Werner is a technical sergeant in the New Hampshire Air National Guard, assigned to the 157th Security Forces Squadron at Peace. He was deployed to Ali As Salem Air Base in Kuwait from July 25th till February 4th with his unit, along with troops from Connecticut, Pennsylvania, and New Mexico. While there, he was in charge of a quick response force patrolling in a Humvee and providing base security for a geographically separated, undisclosed coalition air base. The area Sergeant Werner was patrolling was active with ISIS threats against military personnel, foreign diplomats, and the local mosque. And again, this is our way from the city of Portsmouth and from the police department to thank Bill for his service and to welcome him home. Thank you. Auxiliary Officer Alan Laughlin, please. Welcome back. Thanks. And I had the opportunity to meet Alan when he first came back. One of the first things he did was come up and wanted to meet the new chief. Probably a good move, but it was, you know, meant a lot more for me than it did for him coming into the office. Auxiliary Officer Alan Laughlin serves as a Lieutenant Colonel Infantry Officer in the United States Marine Corps Reserves. From January through December of 2017, he mobilized and deploys as the Executive Officer for an 850-man Crisis Response Task Force. The task force was based in southern Spain and in Sicily. They supported operations and provided crisis response for United States interest in North, West, and Central Africa. I can't say enough. You know, we have a lieutenant colonel who's executive officer for an 850-man unit, and we're, you know, pleased to have him as an auxiliary officer here in the city of Portsmouth. So thank you and welcome home. I'd like to have Officer Christopher Worthington and Officer Jack Maloney come up, please. So on Wednesday, February 7, 2018, just after 6:30 in the evening, you responded to the Market Street overpass for a report of a motor vehicle collision with serious bodily injury. The crash involved a Honda Civic and a 53-foot tractor trailer. We now know the driver of the Honda lost control of the vehicle. It spun out and came to rest in the middle of the highway where it was hit by the tractor trailer. Different print here. The force of the impact caused the two vehicles to come to rest on opposite sides of the highway. The weather that night was a combination of freezing rain, rapidly dropping temperatures, which created the treacherous conditions for black ice. I'll just ad lib a little bit here. That night was a horrendous night on the roads. It was icy, it was rainy, it was windy, it was cold. And those are the types of nights that police officers dread when they're responding to calls. You both were first on scene. You found the passenger in the Honda not breathing and without a pulse. The driver was unresponsive and struggling to breathe. Both victims presented severe head and body trauma. Chris, you directed Officer Maloney to retrieve the automated external defibrillator from your cruiser as you cleared debris from the cabin. Jack, when you returned with the AED, you both worked to stabilize the vehicle while monitoring the condition of the driver and comforting him to the best of your ability. As additional officers arrived, you delegated other critical tasks, including assessing the driver of the semi, managing traffic, and maintaining scene stability. Because of the location of the crash, responding fire apparatus actually had to drive several miles past the collision to a crossover where they could safely turn around and double back to the scene. This complication, coupled with the now extremely icy roads, hampered their response time. This resulted in both of you having to continue life-saving efforts for nearly 10 minutes before you were relieved. The fire captain, the commander of State Police Troop A, along with State Police Captain Chris Vetter, all contacted the shift commander to commend the response of the Portsmouth officers. The director of trauma services for Portsmouth Regional Hospital specifically commended both of you, stating, "They provided her with every opportunity to survive." Chris and Jack, your efforts to preserve life went above and beyond and clearly demonstrate your dedication to safeguarding the people we serve. Your work has brought credit to the entire Portsmouth Police Department, and I am proud of you for it. Congratulations. Officer Worthington was additionally recognized a little over a week ago by Lieutenant Maloney with another letter of recognition as well. Last one I have here, last but not least, Officer Keegan Pearl. This is the Chief's Achievement Award, and this award was put together by the sergeants, one of the sergeants in particular who works with Keegan day in and day out for the entire year. This is to certify that Officer Keegan Pearl has been awarded the Portsmouth Police Department's Chief Achievement Award for 2017, as per the following. Officer Pearl was recognized several times throughout the year for his investigative work, as well as his compassion for the general public, including a letter of commendation regarding his actions with an armed suicidal person, his poised demeanor during a high-risk motor vehicle stop on New Year's Eve allowed for the safe resolution of an incident that involved a motor vehicle pursuit and the recovery of a 9mm handgun. Keegan was recognized again on July 24, 2017 by a community member on Facebook who recounted his thoroughness regarding a serious ongoing neighborhood problem. During a November felony-level domestic violence investigation, Keegan was recognized again by both supervisors and detectives for his thoroughness and compassion in the investigation that led to the arrest of a violent felon. He completes multi-layered complex investigation, always looks beyond the traffic stop, possesses a keen eye for narcotics investigation. He's proficient in writing and executing search warrants leading to bigger seizures. He led the department in 2017 with 113 arrests, 698 motor vehicle stops, 11 warrant arrests. Officer Pearl has exhibited an unparalleled proactive work ethic and willingness to exceed preconceived standards. The Chief's Achievement Award and ribbon is awarded to one or more individuals on an annual basis for outstanding duty performance. We have one more thing for you, Keegan, that I was looking for. And everybody that came into the office to see this had to wipe it down afterwards. But seeing as how the patrol officers don't have an office to hang things on the wall, this is the Chief's Award for Outstanding Performance for the year for Keegan. That concludes this part of the meeting. Everybody is welcome to stay if you so like. I just want you to note that, you know, the non-public meetings with the police commission can get pretty violent, as you see. So I'm doing the best I can.
Keep them in line. And maybe we've got the next generation of officers out here. We'll see. Thanks for coming.
Better and better. Ceremonies. Yeah.
2-0. I know all these guys personally now. You know what I mean?
And yeah. But the handshake, the whole thing is just, we're doing it better. Don't you think?
Yeah, absolutely. That was thanks to
give some good
Commissioner Spine.
Yeah. But I wanted more blood. I just wanted more
yeah.
blood.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so we will return to the agenda as listed above, and the next item on the agenda is acceptance of the meeting minutes for January 23rd. Do I have a motion?
So move to accept the minutes.
Move to accept. Second?
A second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. The chair votes aye, and the meeting minutes from January 23rd are accepted. And we have another set of minutes to accept, and that is the public hearing we held on Valentine's evening on February 14th to give some broad brushstrokes to our anticipated or planned budget for next year. And may I have a motion to accept those minutes?
I have a question first.
Okay.
Who does the minutes? Who actually does the minutes?
I do.
They are so nice.
Yeah,
they're very clear. You make us all sound better than we are.
Thank you, Commissioner.
So thank you.
It costs a lot of money, though. We have to, yeah.
Yeah.
No, Kathy's always doing a terrific job on the meeting minutes. And do I have a second?
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Chair votes aye. Meeting minutes from February 14th are accepted. We now move on to public comment. And as always, we grant citizens 5 minutes to share any thoughts they have about police department matters. Do we have anybody in the audience who would like to come up and speak?
Who do you want to keep track of 5 minutes? This is the machine, but it doesn't seem to have
yeah,
5 minutes.
So I can do it. And,
keep track?
Yeah, this.
Get carried away, Jim.
This gentleman needs to be timed, absolutely. Would you?
Mark Brighton, 285 Union.
It's not on, Mark. It doesn't sound like.
Yeah. How about the other one, Mark? Yeah, good.
I could do it without amplification, I'm sure. Mark Brighton, 285 Union Street. I'm flying without notes. That's never a good sign. I know nothing about police tactics. But there is no doubt in my mind, especially after the presentation the chief just made, that if something happened, something at Portsmouth High happened, like happened down in Parkland, knock on wood, it doesn't, there's no doubt in my mind that you or any of your officers of patrolmen would go to the sound of the gunfire. They wouldn't do what happened to the Broward County sheriffs. So I am utterly confident that that is true. I think, well, I've heard many statements so far. One is that there's never been a school shooting in Israel because they obviously harden their schools. We might not want to go to the extreme that those people have to go to, but I think it'd be good to hear about what the possibilities are. I think that one of the things that makes, I mean, we civilians, we never know how we're going to react in any particular crisis situation, but you and your gentlemen are trained, and training makes all the difference. So I think it would behoove us to have someone trained with a gun in the high school. I just don't see how we get away with it any other way. And you wouldn't even hear me squawk about the cost of the officer. That's how much we need it, I believe. So any words about what's going to be happening? I think one of the other things that we've heard is that high schools have been loath to report kids who may be in trouble to the police officers. We need to check in with the high school. I'm sure you probably already have, but it needs to be impressed upon not you or your officers, but upon the high school, the necessity of reporting kids, not to do anything other than get them some help. Absolutely. But we need to be very aware of what's happening up at that high school, because we all know it could happen here. I'm sure there's one or two students up there who are potentially violent. I mean, that's just the way it is now. So let us know what's going on. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. I think this is the purview of the school department, but we had a non-public earlier tonight, and we're inquiring ourselves, and I think the chief can provide an update right now if he'd like.
So thank you, Mark, and it's been a discussion. Just so that everybody's aware, we had done a walkthrough of Portsmouth High School about a week before, unfortunately, the tragedy in Parkland, Florida. We do have an armed police officer, school resource officer, Detective Kozlowski, who is assigned to the high school daily. And in his absence, we have an officer that goes in his place. We also have an armed officer at the middle school, Detective Tim Cashman. And prior to the tragedy in Parkland, we had had a meeting. We will be conducting a public meeting, and we have a tentative date, so I don't want to ironclad it, of March 20th. I met again today with the school superintendent. It's our third such meeting in the last week or so, and my command staff. We have emergency procedures put together and have been in place prior to my arrival, and I credit Lieutenant Chris Cummings for all the work he's done putting those plans together. I have meetings coming up on the 7th of March, the 8th of March, the 13th of March, and again the 20th of March with various schools. In the past week, we have conducted lockdowns at three of our lower schools, Little Harbor, New Franklin, and Dondero. We will continue those types of exercises, and we have ongoing security procedures, working very closely with the school superintendent and the principals in the coming weeks. And a lot of that will be outlined. I have a school committee meeting, I want to say on the 13th, Mark, that I will be present at, along with the school committee. And the 20th, we're planning a joint meeting, which hopefully will include parents and students at the high school. It's, again, those dates, that the 20th date is tentative right now. We're just ironing out some of the details of that, which should include, you know, members of the city management, as well as the police, fire, schools, et cetera, so that we can let everybody know how well prepared we are. And again, you're not going to prevent every avenue, but we're pretty well prepared. We also, to address your last point, we're looking at a multifaceted approach from police, schools, social service providers, mental health professionals, in the event that we see individuals that need to be reached out to separately that may come along upon the radar.
Thank you, Chief, and obviously a lot of upcoming information and meetings and opportunities for the public to be informed. Serious matters, obviously. Anybody else in the audience would like to provide public comment? Seeing there's no other citizen wanting to provide public comment, we'll close this portion of the meeting and move on to unfinished business. And as part of unfinished business, we have some more meeting minutes to accept. This is the December 19th commission meeting, of which I was the only member in attendance because we've lost those two commissioners. But I've reviewed those minutes and they look quite fine. And accurate. Can I have a motion to accept the meeting minutes?
So moved.
May I have a second?
A second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. And the meeting minutes will go on to record. Thank you. We have some new business, and the new business is one item. Commissioner Splain would like to talk about conducting police commission meetings off-site. Elsewhere in town.
Actually, the thought is, I do not have a motion for this meeting, but would like to offer one at the next meeting, the next regular monthly meeting, on this concept, and maybe I can come up with a list to propose and hear from the other commissioners between now and then. The idea is to not necessarily hold meetings, not too many anyway, because of the logistics involved, but more like forums in some of the parts of the city, the neighborhoods, that can contain a variety of concepts. So one could be, I mean, at one place we could meet would be the recycling center on perhaps a morning or an afternoon on a Saturday. It's quite busy there. I often go and have a table and invite people to talk with members of the commission and some of the police leadership that may come about some of the concerns that Portsmouth residents have. Mostly Portsmouth residents go to the recycling center. Perhaps a meeting at the high school involving some of the classes might be a good idea. I'm talking about long term, the next year or two, we could come up with a list. Certainly some of the other schools for neighborhood forums of sort with the people in the area who might want to come to talk about issues of enforcement, speeding, some of the concerns that they may have in their neighborhood, so that we're kind of outreaching, reaching out, rather than just meeting behind a table higher than the rest of the public that might want to talk with us. I know the chief, the good chief, has been doing some neighborhood walks, some walks, I should say, walk with the chief, and perhaps that's some element that we could do too, also as a commission, with the chief and some others. It seems to me that the one thing that has been missing in previous commissions through the years, and I've been here all my life and been watching them since, well, actually we've always had a police commission in government, more recently since 1987, a commission that has been elected, is the kind of involvement of the public. And since we need to more than ever, I think, in 2018, as we go on, would find ways to be able to involve and relate with the public, and the good chief and the current department has been doing much of that, we can find and invent, create new ways to do that. So I see no downside to this. It could provide dialogue, the forums in particular, as well as a meeting at the school, maybe something at a senior citizen center. So I offer that as a concept that perhaps at the next meeting I can assemble a list. Each of us could think of that and list half a dozen possibilities for locations, share it, maybe vote on a schedule for the next 6 months, see how they go, and do them and find ways to be able to. I mean, we had a lot of people today come to the meeting, but only one person talking with us, and I think Mark Brighton is the first citizen to talk with this commission that took office in January. So we need more of that. I mean, we all learn from the public. So that's what I wanted to suggest on this item.
Yeah, so, you know, logistically, I think it'll be a little tricky to maybe get a camera and audio and have it be part of our official monthly commission meetings. But, you know, and I think we've mentioned this in a previous, last month, that we're all receptive to, extending the chief's coffee with a cop. You did that at down on the square, I believe.
And we'll start our walk with a...
And then you'll start your walks. And so we could have, commission coffee and cops, have a couple officers in leadership command positions, patrol officers and the commissioners, and just have an informal conversation with the public. I think it's a terrific idea. In the school setting, it'll be a little tricky because of the privacy rights of kids and not having cameras there. That's why I think it's got to be informal without cameras. But I think it's a great idea, and the more we talk to the public and get people interested in city government, particularly the running of the police department, and we're not spring chickens up here. We're going to need new commissioners sometime down the road, and it would be great to have some members of the public get interested in what we're up to and replacing us in the near or distant future. So I think it's a great idea. Anybody else on this topic? All right, well then we'll move on to the rest of the chief's agenda items.
Yeah, so I'll start with the accreditation update. As you know, we're in year two of the accreditation process from CALEA, and obviously we're still over 99% on our standard operating procedures, and now we go into what we call the proofs. We currently have 13% of our proofs for year one, which is 123 total proofs, which proofs, as I explained earlier, are just not that we have these standard operating procedures, but they are that we are actually doing what the procedures say that we are doing. And for year two, we are at 14% of the proofs, or total of 134 proofs. And just to give you an idea of the level of work that's involved in this, we, by CALEA standards, we do approximately 1,000 proofs per year. So we're still ahead of schedule. We anticipate, and speaking with the two individuals, Lieutenant Darren Sargent and Jackie Burnett, that do this for my shop. As I always say, we should get our CALEA accreditation in March of 19, and they always remind me that, no, we will get our CALEA accreditation in March of 19. But we're already into the phase of proving both for year one and year two that not only do we have those standard operating procedures up and running, but that we're actually doing what we say we're doing. And it's pretty stringent work, so I can't credit them enough. Our monthly traffic data, again, as everybody knows, the officers are continuing on raising the bar as to our number of traffic stops that are being made. In December of 17, we had a total of 656 traffic stops just in the month, which in prior years might be 14 and 15. Those were the number, three times the number of traffic stops for the year. And in January, 688 motor vehicle stops for the month of January. I can tell you that, and I don't have to tell everybody, that the weather wasn't always great in December and January. These officers, as you know, are out there all weather, and they're continuing their, this is all proactive work on their part, self-initiated work, as you heard from some of the accommodations earlier in the night. We have put together more plans for traffic enforcement as we move into the spring and summer months. We had purchased equipment, the latest equipment. It's actually better than anything that's being used in the state right now for the motorcycle noise, which I know Commissioner Anosco had numerous residents talk about to him. We have two officers that are going through training so that as the motorcycle season begins, and I know it, we had a brief 170-degree day there where the bikes came out pretty early, we will have enforcement. There was just recently some legislation that was introduced and is looking to pass that there will not, we cannot have separate motor vehicle motorcycle checkpoints, much like the DUI checkpoints. However, that was never our intention. These will be officers that are on regular patrol that will have the ability to do noise checks and so forth on motorcycles, especially in the residential and downtown areas, as people are sitting out and enjoying the city of Portsmouth. So at the same time, you know, we've heard the concerns of the motorcycle operators, many of whom like the loud mufflers for safety reasons. So we're trying to balance out our enforcement along with education for the operators and the general public. Our strategic plan, I can just mention, and you'll be hearing more about that in our upcoming budget presentations, but we have put together a five-year strategic plan with all of our units under our command here, under my command, and we are doing short-term 1 year as to what we're doing, and then putting a strategic plan together for the next 5 years, which the units have all done. Karen Senecal and I have met with everybody, and the strategic plan will include not only what we're doing, but covering the budgetary process as to what our outlooks will be for the next 5 years, so that we're not here before the police commission or the city council or city manager saying we need money for this or that. We're trying to do it strategically so that we spread it out over 5 years and we know exactly what we'll be looking at down the road. Again, we also know that those things change from time to time. There's some malleability in there, but we want to have a strategic plan for this department going forward for the next 5 years.
If I may offer a thought on this, I think the strategic planning that you're assembling is excellent. You talked about that at the last meeting too. When I was on the city council some time ago, I suggested that we consider 2050 visioning. The concept of really looking ahead, and the closer that we get to it, it's only 28 years from now, is that right, 28, 38, 48, 32, to 2050. And the more that we vision, the more that we look ahead, the more I think that the better that we plan, and the more that we consider all of the possibilities of what we should be doing today. In 1991, I proposed and we undertook a series of forums in Portsmouth called the 2020 Vision Project, the Portsmouth 2020 Vision Project. And in fact, at one of the forums that we had with about 100 people at Yokin's Restaurant, Eileen Foley, this is 1991, and you know, that's quite a while ago technology-wise, Eileen Foley offered, and she got some laughs about this, that in 2020, people would walk around with computers in their wallets and pocketbooks. And that's long before the concept of the iPhone. And the city manager at the time, I think it was Ken Mahoney, offered that on the horizon, and we've got recordings of all of this, Portsmouth Herald did some stories as well, and I think it was May 22nd, 1991, Ken Mahoney, the city manager at that time, suggested that there was going to be a fear by 2020 about sea level rise. And nobody was talking about that, at least, you know, as a general discussion at that time. And I think that's always useful. And I would be fascinated to hear the chief and professionals in our police department, citizens, others perhaps who might be interested in this from outside the city, suggesting what policing would look like in the year 2050, what kinds of things we have to be concerned about. The world will be different then. But when you think about it, 2050 is equidistant to us from the 1980s and 90s now. And while the world was different then, several decades ago, it is quite similar. So anyway, I suggest that we think about that. And I'm not, again, proposing anything particular, but along with your strategic planning for 5 years, we might begin to extrapolate the long-term vision of what policing will be like and what kinds of things we need to start planning for, and maybe even having a forum or two someday.
I think it's a great idea.
I'm assuming at the national level there are some speculative groups that get together and think about long-range planning, right?
When we have various, you know, the International Association Chiefs of Police and Police Executive Research Forum, they look 20, 30 years out in policing.
Yeah.
So yeah. I plan on being here in 32 years, not as the chief, but being around in 32 years, just
yeah,
so
I'll wheel you around.
My math might not be good, but I know that 2050 is coming.
Yes, and it could be one of our conversations with the public. You know, one of our informal conversations. We'd have to do some homework and have a conversation. So
a lot of the kids who are here today will be in their 40s in 2050.
Yeah.
And if they're going to be living in Portsmouth or wherever they live, I think they'd like to offer some thoughts about the kind of world they would like to see. Mark Brighton might as well, because I think he'll be here by then.
On to grants and donations?
Or financial report first?
Either one. I've got the strategic plan, and then I've got your financial report on 9.
Okay.
8 is grants and donations?
Yep.
So we have a safe and active grant has been awarded to the Portsmouth Police Department from the Children's Hospital at Dartmouth. The first portion of the grant awards the department 25 multi-sport helmets and the second portion awards the department a supply of reflective devices, literature, a banner, and other materials to promote injury prevention among children. So,
great. Terrific. Need to make so a motion we, to accept we need a motion to accept this this find a gift from the Children's Hospital at
so
Dartmouth.
So moved.
Second.
Seconded. And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Chair votes aye, and the motion passes. And any thoughts on how you're going to use those, Chief?
Yes, we're working with our community outreach officers, and we're planning a day where we can bring in children from around the city, especially those most need of how do we distribute all the safety gear as well as the multi-use helmets.
Fantastic. Well, that'll be a fun day. On to Karen Senecal's financial report.
Sorry, I was just so excited.
Yes, yeah, so it's, you always do such a good job on the budget.
At this point in the fiscal year, we are 2.5% below the cap, despite having an overtime tracking at 10% over their line item, which equates to about $53,000. About 40 to 45% of our overtime is spent on coverage, and that's usually what drives the excess. But we have salary savings that can cover that overage right now at this point in the fiscal year. So I don't anticipate that we would have to ask for a contingency or anything from the city council on that. Our budget documents and whatnot are being prepared to submit to the finance department for FY19. In terms of grants, we just got the New Hampshire Highway Safety grant solicitation. So we'll be submitting applications by the end of March that will start October 1st for all the pedestrian, the DUI, et cetera, all the regular grants that we get from them. So those will be submitted shortly. We're still waiting to hear on the Elks grant for our Cops with Kids event. They're going to be trying to give us enough money, not only for our goodie bags that we do for the kids, but several other items that Detective Jones asked for in reference to being able to have one of the cutouts for an officer so that the kids can stick their face in it and you can take a picture and show just different things that she wanted that would help with that. And I think fingerprint kits that the kids could take home to their parents and have their parents do their fingerprints. In terms of the facility, we've been documenting quite a bit of problems with the building, mainly leaks, mold, etc. So we're putting everything, we've got the whole department contributing. We have a share file on the computer that Captain Warcall is compiling, and we'll hopefully have a list for you at some point for that. In terms of our fleet, we just received our two SUVs for patrol. One is going to be a solid black with the shadow emblem, I guess, on it.
Breast.
And then one regular black and white. And then today we just got the two detective car replacements that were on the rolling stock. So those are going to be sent to Two-Way to be set up, so they'll be on the road shortly. And then last and not least, the public survey, our intern has been working with people on my staff, and we should hopefully have things mailed out by next week. So there will be 5,000 residents in Portsmouth that will receive the survey. UNH prepared just a list for us to do. They got the list from the post office, and they did different sections of the city to get a nice sampling. So hopefully 5,000 people will get those surveys and complete them and get them back, and we should have a report before we go into our work session with the city council for budget.
Let's hope we get a high response rate.
That would be great.
Anything
I think
else?
That's it. Nope.
All right, terrific. Any questions for Karen? Okay. Letters of thanks and appreciation from outside the department, Chief.
Besides all the ones that we did earlier, this is a resident. A resident was a recent victim of burglary. She wanted to let us know that Detective Seth Tondro was assigned to the case. She wanted us to know that he has been so kind, considerate, diligent, and compassionate as he works her case. She stated it is obvious that his heart and soul are put into his work and appreciates the professionalism he has exhibited. As you know, we've been receiving many of these commissioners that have come across, and it's really good to hear from the public that they appreciate the work that the officers and detectives are conducting on a day-to-day basis.
Terrific. All right, that's the end of the, go ahead.
In line with that, am I to understand that you as chair have asked for the website to be updated so that people can click on a button and offer both thanks to officers as well as mentions of concern? Or how is that going?
Yeah, we have a page. It's a commendations and complaints page, and that's up and running.
Right.
There are a number of ways in which a citizen can provide a commendation or a complaint. At that website, the commendations and complaint page, it's a separate page, you can contact the chief through his email. There is a department email. There is a commission phone line. And there is a commission email address that will go to all three of us. And as well, you can email the commissioners separately or call a private line that each of the commissioners has by clicking on their picture at the commission homepage. And so there are lots of ways to address the police department and the police commission for anyone who has concerns. And I think most of those edits have been...
will be done by tomorrow.
Will be done by tomorrow, yeah.
And I was going to say there was one other that they could call the shift commander too if it's
shift commander is also listed as a possibility. So there are lots of ways to contact both commendations and complaints.
Or the chief, correct?
Yep.
Yeah, correct.
The chief, yeah, absolutely. He's listed at both our website and at the commendations and complaints page. All set on that?
Yes.
Yeah, thanks for bringing that up. Do any of the commissioners have any miscellaneous or other business?
I do have one. Maybe I'm mistaken, but I did not notice on the, and we're desirous of being very transparent, and I understand there may be some logistics involved, but I do know that on the City Council information page, whenever they hold a meeting, the agenda is posted on, I think, a late Thursday, and then the packet of materials which will accompany the agenda, which is available publicly, not the confidential items, but the public information is then posted as a packet on Friday for the following Monday meeting. And I did not notice that for today's meeting of the Police Commission. I did notice that some previous meetings of the Police Commission has had that, and I think it might have been more of an oversight, unless I was looking at the wrong part of the the website. But maybe that can have some attention in the future, that whenever we have informational packet items that is not confidential, that indeed should be shared with the public, or would otherwise be shared with the public if they came in, that we try to put it on the website ahead of time for the meeting coming up as soon as reasonable. Most of our meetings are Tuesday, perhaps Friday would be good, at least so that there's some awareness. Is that any problem with that?
Yeah. Huh? The nature of the commission business. Sorry, thank you, Chairman. The nature of the commission business is that it is not fixed, the police business. It's not fixed. In other words, this particular meeting, there were changes to that packet late on Friday. There were changes, and there were actually changes on Monday. So it does present a bit of a challenge, which is why in the past we have put the packet up right after the meeting. The packet gets scanned in and sent upstairs for the City Council to post, for the City IT to post it on the website so that a record of the information is available to the public. The other piece of that is that, it is a matter of just one person doing more than one job.
It would seem to me that, particularly since we only have one meeting a month, Or usually, probably be some special meetings from time to time as we do some prep and catch up, that at least whatever information could be available should be posted as a packet. I mean, even the city council, in my 4 years of experience, you know, and some of the packets went on to 700, 800 pages. You'll see that this week in the city council packet, quite thick. I mean, there's a lot of minutiae that is given to the city councilors. We used to get them in hard copy, and now most of it is indeed, to save paper and oversight, online for the city councilors as well as the public. But even with the city council and the good city manager and other managers, they add stuff. They add items, data, on Monday night and give it to them. But at least a good part of the items are posted ahead of time, and I really like what you summarized about after the meeting, all of the information is shared. But really, the public deserves and expects, I think, a little advance notice for anything that is on an agenda item if it's available. So perhaps a little bit of work can be done, and maybe you know, there's somebody in IT or the city who we can ask to assist. If need be, because I know that with our administrative staff being as limited as it is, I mean, two, three people do a lot of work, and that's appreciated.
Could I add a comment to that? I think that I hear what you're saying, and I appreciate that. I think it's sufficient if we're able to just put the agenda out. The agenda would let people know what's on the agenda. And if it's something that interests them, they would come. I just don't see the need to do all of that. The packets, whatever, for this. That's just my opinion. It also, you know.
Yeah. So maybe there's not a formal motion here, but it's just a friendly suggestion that whenever possible, we add to the agenda items relevant information that would be beneficial to the public prior to the meeting. And if that can't be done, It'll appear the next day after the meeting, and we can provide clarification during the meeting. So you know, I think it's a good idea given the constraints that we have in the department. It's a lean and mean department. Kathy's doing a ton of things, and I get it. And a lot of these agenda items come up at the end, near the Tuesday of our meeting. So when possible, I think is the suggestion.
Yes, and I think a concerted effort can do it, and we'll see how that goes. You know, public transparency as well as the public's right to know really cannot be compromised. I mean, there are laws on that, in fact, but much of this information is supplemental and kind of goes beyond the legal obligations. But I think that whenever we can, we should try to provide that information. And I think the observation that you just made, good chair, kind of summarizes it well.
All righty. On to miscellaneous other business. Any other items? I have one, and that is to propose a work session of the police commission and the chief and the budget manager, Karen Senecal, to discuss in more detail the budget plan for next year. And we were kicking around the possibility of something next, as early as next week, my schedule's pretty busy. I know others are. I was going to propose maybe Thursday morning, March 8th, which would be 9 days from now, maybe 9 to 11, a 2-hour public meeting. We'll sit out at a table here or in some other location in the city and review in more detail the budget. The chief laid out the broad brushstrokes of a budget plan, but we could dig deeper as a commission, along with the chief and Karen.
Did you say 9th?
Thursday the 9th, the 8th.
Yep.
Thursday the 8th, maybe 9 to 11 in the morning. Does that work?
Yes. Works for me.
That would be contingent on availability. I don't think it'll be a problem, but I'll check with the city.
And the worst case scenario is we hold
it in
the
air.
Go to my office.
Yeah.
As long as it's public.
Well, there'll be a million citizens, so we'll have to probably use the bigger venue. Yeah.
Like I said, we can use it in my office.
Okay, great. So we've got that established, and we'll get that out for as a public notice. And I think that concludes the commission meeting. And our next regular meeting will be held on Tuesday, March 27th. Here at 5:30, we'll have the non-public session begin at 4:30. May I have a
just motion? For clarification on the work session, which I think is a good idea. It's certainly going to be public and publicly noticed. And as a work session, we would not take any votes. There would not be action there. There may be some consensus, but there would not be any action, correct?
Correct.
On the budget?
If we came to consensus as a group, why wouldn't we want to do that?
Because it would be posted as a work session. I know the work sessions of the city council, and I think this is true of the school board as well, never by tradition, I suppose, have entailed actual action. It seems to me that the work session may or may not be televised because of where it may be. And I would be uncomfortable if we were to plan on any action, and we have another police commission meeting, maybe a special one later this coming month, and maybe that would be the best approach to make it clear that we are not going to, at work sessions, take an official vote on something.
So the next meeting would then be March 27th, our next police commission meeting. Would that, if we made some budget decisions that late in the game, will that work?
I talked to the finance director, and she said that we've made changes after the budget book has been printed before, and we just do a summary slide for the city council to show them, the status quo, changes after a meeting with the city manager, whatever changes we make, we just walk them through that and show them, even if the number that we finally present at the work session is not the same as what's in the budget book, we work.
So that will work out.
Yeah, she says just to do what I've done in the past, and she said that would be fine.
Okay, because you said that we go to print in early April.
Correct, and she said.
So we'd still have almost a week after the March 27th meeting.
Potentially, but she said everything is linked and everything's pretty much ready to go by the last week of March. So she said it's no problem. She said it's no problem. We've done it many times in the past where between the budget book being printed and the budget presented to the work session with the city council, things happen.
Yeah.
And, decisions, can be made post. And what we've done in the past is just do a slide in our budget presentation right off the bat, exactly what's what.
So as usual, Karen can make it work, but it does sound like it would be a slight inconvenience possibly. And so let's find out if we can make some decisions at a work session. And if that isn't a violation of some New Hampshire law, then we'll leave that as a possibility. How's that? It's a public meeting. It'll be audio recorded minimally, possibly videotaped. I'm sensing some reservations.
Well, I'm hesitant about saying yes, simply for the matter that I think there is time, and if we if we wanted to or needed to follow up this March 8th meeting with some actual formal decision making, and that's the difference between consensus and actual voting. I mean, we could set up a special public police commission meeting before the 25th.
7th, yeah.
27th.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I mean, we do have options.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, that's a possibility.
Plenty of options.
Yeah. Okay. So a work session with felt consensus without votes, and if need be, we'll have another meeting to spare Karen some last-second budget changes.
Well, I was going to say, in that work session, you might have questions that I might not have the ready answer for, so you're going to need to be provided information.
Yeah, but if we're in agreement about something, I was just proposing we could make the decision that day, but we won't. All righty, any other good business for the department? All right, may I have a motion to adjourn the meeting?
So moved.
All right, seconded. And all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Chair votes aye, and the meeting is adjourned.